unless when you try to do the computation at the end of the last year assignment, you might want to utilize your B+3 implementation to speed up your query processing. But it's not a required element of your B+3. But potentially, you might want to speed up your query processing using your B+3. Does that make sense? However, it does depend on your Lab 1 and the buffer eviction code in your Lab 2 implementation. Okay? So you start with a simple filter and a join. We ask you to implement 2 join algorithms. One is the simple nested loop join. I briefly talked about that toward the end of last lecture. And then the other is hash join, which we will be talking about today. And then you will be required to implement the aggregate operation. Then some function related with heap file, basically removing and adding tuples, insertion and deletion. And then you will do this query workflow. Okay? And at the end of this implementation, as I mentioned to you, the parser is given to you. So you don't have to write a parser. The parser is provided in this library called zsql.jar. So it's already given to you. Okay? Parser there. And at the end of this lab, you should be able to run this SimpleDB interface that accepts SQL as input. And there is a context at the end of the Lab 3. You download this dataset. This dataset is not big. So let me show you what the dataset looks like. So for example, this is my DBLP record. It shows all the publications I have. And it does so for literally all papers in computer science field. Okay? So it is a large database, but in our case, we get a small, really tiny, teeny subset of that. It's about, the whole data set is about 20 megabytes, or something like that. So it's very, very small, so that you can actually, your implementation can actually finish in a reasonable amount of time. Even if you have a really lousy implementation, you should still be able to finish executing the query in reasonable time, in tens of seconds. That's what I mean by reasonable. Okay? And you basically will be required to run these 3 queries. Okay? First of all, you need to run them without any error time, obviously. Mm-hmm. Then you document the time taken for each of these queries. Then the winner will be decided by the total running time of the 3 queries. Of course, I understand you have different machines, right? So somebody having a super powerful CPU will be having an advantage against somebody using a not so powerful CPU. So what we will do is, I will ask the TAs, once you submit your Lab 3 code, and we'll ask the TA to run these 3 queries against your implementation on Georgia server. Each of you have an account to Georgia, right? So you can actually test over there. And TA, of course, will verify your results. You cannot say, oh, I used only 1 second. We have to rerun your code on Georgia to reproduce that result. And then the winner will get $50 from me. Okay? $50 Amazon gift card. I will present that gift card in class. Okay? And the second place will get $25. And no third place. What if we have time? That's a good question, right? If we have time, I hope we don't have time. I will give 2 awards. If we have multiple implementations that are really, really close, like the difference is within 1 second, then I may be considering giving multiple awards. Okay? That's okay. So for $50 and $25, I do have a deep pocket. And we're not talking about $5,000, okay? So in my interest, I hope there will be no ties, okay? So of course, you guys, that's another interesting question, the security problem. And you guys can actually conclude, all of you say, okay, we all have really lousy implementations. And then all of us kind of share that $50. Right, so basically do nothing and do really bad implementation. But you have to convince all the team to do that, which is not so easy to do, right? Okay, that makes sense? Of course, you can be creative. You say, okay, if all of you do that, I got $50, right? So I will share my $20 with you if you do that. So you still get $30, right? But I don't think that will happen, right? So basically, try the best you can. If you use the base implementation, as suggested in the document, chances are you won't be able to win the competition. Okay? You have to implement algorithms that we discussed in class but not required in this live assignment in order to have a sufficient, especially for the joint. Hash joint will be pretty good. So I think it boils down to which team has the best hash joint implementation. Okay? Alright, so let me show you what at the end of the day what this looks like.
Can we hard code in the results and then just get them from memory?
The TAs will look at code, of course. So this script is given to you. Okay? So this shell script is provided to you. Okay. If you run it, it asks for a catalog file. So you use the DBLP. Let me show you first of all this schema, what it looks like. So this is what the schema looks like. So have authors, venues, papers, and paper authors. So which author published which paper at what venue, at what conference or journal. Okay? So fairly simple schema. And the data is about, so the largest table is author table, about 19 megabytes. Okay. And these are converted to the particular format that SimpleDB can understand. Okay, so we started with the text file, we encode it into SimpleDB format. So it's a binary format. You try to look at it. So this is a binary format. Okay. Okay, it's already been encoded. Okay. Now we do this. We start the So at end of your last three implementation, you should be able to do this. You should be able to run SimpleDB front end, load your schema, and get a command line interface like this. And what you do, copy the queries. Shows the query plan, and of course you are not doing the optimization, all that stuff, right? So your output might be slightly different from this, but you should be able to get the results and get the execution time. This is what we are looking for. Okay? So the first query is fairly simple, it's just a simple selection. As you can see, this actually is just a keep file scan, right? Because in order to support a like operator, unless you have an index on that name attribute, you have to do a keep file scan. So this query plan basically do a scan and projection, sorry, selection and projection. The second query is a little bit more complicated, it's a join. So it shows you the query plan. By the way, it asks you basically that four. Are you going to do curl? Which will produce a curve plan like this. Okay. This one takes about 1 second in my implementation, of course. The last one is the most complicated one. that is a join over multiple tables. So this plan is fairly sophisticated. Not surprising, because this plan is, this query is complex, right? So the plan is complex as well. You see that? And it takes about 3 to 4 seconds. Of course, this is on my machine. This is a fairly good machine, not super powerful, but a fairly good machine. With a good i7 CPU and sufficient memory and all that stuff. So on your machine, I don't know how long this will take. And with your invitation, right? So maybe you even can beat my invitation. That's possible, right? It's totally possible. And what we do is, at the end of the day, we add up this time, and the first one, the execution time for that. Then we do a run. The number one team, $50. Number two team, $25. Okay? Any question on this? No extension whatsoever, okay? It's due on November 10th. Alright?
And if we beat your implementation, then it's $500.
If you beat mine, I will consider winning the prize. Okay? Alright? Okay? Alright, so let's go back to the slides. Okay, so we talk about query evaluation. Okay, so this is where we are. So we talk about simple nested loop join. So this algorithm is very simple, right? So you basically read every single tuple from the what we call the outer relation, and you scan every tuple of the inner relation. By the end of the day, you scan the outer relation once, but you scan the inner relation multiple times. How many times? The equal to the number of tuples from the outer relation. Does that make sense? So the cost obviously is very high, and one question here is that which one you want to use as outer relation, which one you want to use as inner relation? Because join is commutative, right? So this is the same as this. Well, you really have to do the calculation and figure out which one gives you smaller cost. So another improvement you can do is, instead of doing this, instead of scanning the inner relation for every tuple of the outer relation, you can do it page by page. In other words, why not you hold a page of tuple from the outer relation while scanning the inner relation? Then when you hold that page, one page of tuple, and then scan through them, okay? Then you do a mini nested loop join in memory. This costs you no I/O. So instead of doing tuple by tuple, you hold a page of data and then scan through the other one. Then this guy go one by one, like that. So that's essentially the idea. And the cost of this, obviously, is number of pages from the outer relation times the number of pages from the inner relation, because for every page of the outer relation, you need to scan the inner relation once. Then at the end of the day, you scan the outer relation once, so you have to add that cost. But you can swap the order of the two and get another cost, which is essentially easier. Or So the cost of this operation is essentially this. And if you look at this formula, these two are equivalent. So it's boiled down to this value against this value. So in other words, for this one, you should always use the smaller relation as auto. Okay. Now, the third algorithm is what we call the index method rejoin. The idea if you have an index over the join attribute on either R or S, what you can do is instead of looping through that table in its entirety, what you can do is use that index to fetch those records that match the join attribute value of the current tuple from the outer relation. Okay, so what you do is the following. For every tuple from the outer relation, you use the index to probe the second relation and fetch only those records that satisfy the join condition with respect to the value of the current tuple from the outer relation. Does that make sense? And you can do this over either R or S, depending on which one has an index on its join attribute. If both of them do, then you can swap the order and try which one is more efficient, which one gives you a smaller query cost. And the other optimization you can do is instead of doing for every tuple, you probe this. Instead of doing that, you can actually do every page, right? Load the page into buffer, and then for every tuple in that page, you do this probing, but when you going through the tuple, they don't incur any additional IOs. So this is always better than loading tuple by tuple, right? So that's a trivial optimization you should do, right? With that being said, the cost is simply this. At the end of the day, you have to scan the outer relation once, and for every tuple, that's why this is total number of tuples from the outer relation, you need to multiply that with the cost of retrieving tuple from index on the second relation. Okay. So index next to join, there's an example. I will ask you to read through this example yourself. The calculation first report, so I will skip that. Now, the fourth algorithm, so far we're seeing three algorithms, right? Simple nested join, page nested join, index nested join, and the first one is the next one is block nested join. The idea is the following, okay? It's actually I'm gonna reuse this picture right here. Remember, this is the buffer. The buffer size in M over B. Typically, this is much greater than 1. So in N, what you're doing essentially for every this page, you are looping through all the pages from S. This is the R, this is the S. Right? So one observation we have is that why don't we amortize the cost of looping through all pages from S against multiple pages from R? Instead of doing this for every single page of R, we can amortize this over multiple pages from R. So that being said, instead of loading one page at a time, I'm going to load, then there are more pages to come, right? But I'm going to load these many pages into buffer, these guys, all together coming to buffer, and then I reserve one for this one. Of course, maybe minus two, because I want to reserve one more for the output buffer. When I load this many pages into buffer, I can now loop through the pages in S. So the loop actually looks like this now, because I have one output buffer now. And then I do a in-memory meaning that's loop join between this page, and this page, and this. So every single page, every pair of page between R and S, I join them. And I push to the output, whenever output buffer failed, dump to the disk, empty this. That make sense? This dramatically reduces the number of loops you have to do in order to loop through the pages in S. By how much? Well, you can do a simple calculation. R, the total number of pages in R is N1, remember? Right? So what we have is this many pages divided into how many blocks? This many blocks. Take the ceiling of that. Because each time you are loading this many pages, so it break R into this many blocks. For each block, you loop through S once. Alright? And don't forget, at the end of the day, you have to load entire R once. So I will do this. Okay? Of course, by the fact that by this observation, we get another cost, which is right? If you look at these two formulas, these two values roughly are the same. So it boils down to the relationship between these two values. And what that tells you is, again, you should use the smaller relation as the outer relation. Smaller relation as outer relation. So you always use the smaller relation as outer, and then loop to the bigger one as the inner relation. You get rid of the B factor here and remove this constant. So roughly is something like that. But if you want to be precise, you should involve the involve B in this. Okay? So there's an example, I will again skip that. And this is obviously a huge improvement versus simple nested loop join and page nested loop join, obviously, right? By looking at just the formula, it's obviously a huge improvement. Now, the next one, sophomore join, is to use external sorting to help you with the join, to help you with the join. The idea is the following. The idea is basically you sort R and S with respect to the join attribute. Okay, so what you do is the following. To the join attribute. Of course, assuming we are doing natural or equal join, assuming we are doing natural or equal join, we can sort R and sort S. Of course, with respect to join attribute. With respect to the join attribute. And then what do? The observation now is that those tuples from R that will join with those tuples in S must appear in consecutive blocks because they're sorted by the join attribute. And you're doing equality join. So those pairs of tuples that do join together under this equality condition from R and S must appear in consecutive block in R and consecutive block of S. In other words, if this is R, this is S. The picture must look like the following. You have a consecutive block of R. What that means is those records with, let's say joint attribute is A, A blue blue. No? And then, I assume we'll run out of color, but suppose green is greater than blue, it's sorted, right? Alphabetically, I happen to be right. G is after B, right? Okay. Is that okay? Now, what's the picture on S? S may not have any record with values with blue. So it may have black. And then it has bit blue. Blue is indeed after black. BL, maybe BLU. Does that make sense? Yeah. And I run out of color here. Imagine there's some other color here, then I may have green. This is some other okay. That must be what it looks like for R and S. Must be. Because you sort it. Does that make sense? What do you do now? You initialize two cursors and you look at which value pointed by the two cursors is smaller. You advance the smaller cursor. Look at this two, this has a smaller value. But you advance not by tuple by tuple, you advance block by block. So this will all jump to here. Because all these are the same values. They are not the same record, they are only the record with the same value on the joint attribute. Okay? That's what I mean. Then you get rid of this cursor. Now what do you get? You got two blocks of data from R and S respectively, guaranteed to join. Then you do a mini you join that. This okay. Assuming you have reasonable balanced distribution of your data, this can be done in memory. You load this block, this whole block. By the way, block here doesn't refer to a single page. Typically, when I say a block, it's a single page. But here, a block is a block of pages. You load this block, you load this block into memory, in other words. You load this block. And this block. And then you do the a mini nested loop join in memory now to produce the output. After this, what do? You advance both cursors. And this is guaranteed to be smaller than green, because green in this side is coming after it. So this cursor will stop, and you will advance this cursor again. What do you do now? At the end of the day, what do you do? At the end of the day, what's the cost of this step? What's the cost of this step, second step? Assuming each such block of pages do fit in your main memory, at the end of the day, you scan R1, you scan S1. Those meaning that's in memory does not cost you any additional I/O. So
that's after the external sort.
Yes. So the total cost is what? Okay, so that's essentially the total cost. Right? What's the cost of this? By now you should be able to write this formula without any trouble, right? It's if you're using tournament sort to do the improvement, right? And similar for S. Any question on this algorithm? So far, so good. Okay. There is an example. So 22 and 28, right? So you move 22 to 28. Then this is your, that's your kind of like a blue block right here, and blue block right here. And you do that, then you move to 31 block, then 31 block. Then skip the 44 block, go to 58 block, 58 block. Okay, so that's the cost. Refinement. Okay, now remember last lecture I gave you a refinement on using sorting to do aggregation. Remember that? The baseline approach is what? Is sort R, then linear scan R to do group by aggregation or disking, right? That's the baseline. But then I argued if you can merge all the rungs in one pass, if that condition is true, you can actually combine this into one step. You can do the group by aggregate or duplicate elimination during the merging phase of your sort or join algorithm, right? I discussed that optimization. And what's the condition for that? Well, the condition is you need to merge all the rungs in one pass. And your buffer should be big enough to merge all the rungs from that relation in a single merge attempt, rather than doing multiple merge attempts in a single pass. In other words, M over B minus some constant for output buffer and all that, let's ignore that, must greater or equal than the size, the number of rungs you have, which is if you use tournament sort. If you don't use tournament sort, just a baseline, this condition must be true because this essentially, you need to be able to merge all the rungs in one merging attempt. If that's true, and then you can combine with the merging phase. Right? That's what we said. So instead of doing sort, then another linear scan, you only need to do sort. And that duplicate elimination and group by aggregation is merged into, is combined into the merging phase in your sort of merge one algorithm, right? Yes? Similarly, you can optimize external word sort using a very similar principle. The idea is the following. Okay, I'm going to show you the idea. Okay. The idea is. So what's the idea? The idea is pass 0 is the same. You load R, sort them into rounds, load S, sort them into rounds. Pass 0 is the same. Step 1. i.e. you got round size is the same for both. Round size is, what's the round size? Simply this, M over B. Size is buffer, right? Load this by page, sort them. So this is the same. Now, the second step is what's critical, right? This is what's critical. What you do is the following. Buffer and instead of sort R and sort S independently, I will try to sort them simultaneously and do the join along the way. Okay? So what I'm doing? So this is the S and this is the R. And I gotta divide my buffer as well, extending this line. Of course, I will reserve one of the buffer. Output buffer page, a single output buffer page. You see how this goes, right? So what you do is, so I'm gonna say this is the. B cancels out, right? Right? Each of this has multiple pages, of course. Right? That's what this looks like. Similarly for S. The corresponding tuple from R and S without missing anyone. In other words, if you have some runs here, and this run come to the last page in the region of R, this is the region of R representative, this is the region of S representative. If you have some runs in R that's not represented by a page in the memory buffer. Now, of course, I have cursors. And you're looking at those cursors to produce drawn tuples, you are potentially missing drawn values, drawn records. Otherwise, if that's not the case, if this is the case, suppose this is the case. So I can load a representative page from all the rounds in R and all the rounds in S. If that's the case, what can I do? Well, I can do the sorting while I do the join. Because I basically look at, okay, these values from R, if this cursor point to the same values, and some of this, I'm matching some of the cursors here, I should produce a join for any combination of such cursors. Meaning, if this cursor is 3, this cursor is 3, this is 4, this is 3. How many join output if you have? If you have 2 output. This match with this, and this match with this. Of course, additional attributes. From R and S record respectively, because you are not doing the join for the purpose of just finding the matching values on the join attribute. You do the join for the purpose of, oh, if the join attribute match, I'm interested in finding out the other attributes. So you need to get those additional attributes. So let me complicate the matter a little bit more. So if I have another 3 here, so that should produce, instead of 2, now you should have 4 of. So maybe it's clear if I use different colors. I wish I had another color. So if I don't, I will denote this as clean prime. So that's what happened. All the possible conditions. But the condition for this, the requirement for this to work is that you must have this condition, right? All the rounds are represented in the buffer. Otherwise, if that's not the case, suppose this is the case, then there might be a value 3 here that you move forward the cursor already, then these 3s are not matching with that 3. Miss the opportunity, well, that cannot be right. Okay, so that's the requirement. Now, how do we translate this into a mathematical condition? Well, it's not hard, right? Not hard. What's the mathematical condition here? The total number of rounds from R and S, the total number of rounds from R and S must less equal than 1. Right. This is the condition. You follow me? Yeah? So that's the condition. Of course, if I simplify this a little bit,
So what I'm going to do is the following, right? What I want to do is this, obviously, number one plus R plus number one plus S must less equal than what? 2 times number rounds of the bigger relation. Must be, right? The bigger the relation is, the more rounds you're going to produce. You follow me? Because essentially what it is, this is N1 divided by M plus N2 divided by M. That's the number of rounds from R and S respectively. If you're using the optimization, then it's half of this. Right? If you're using the two-element sort, so that must less equal than when I take L to be the max of N1 or N2, this must be true. Right? No? Yes? 3 plus 5 must less equal than 5 plus 5. Right? Cancel off. And what I refer, this must less equal than OB. So this is a condition. So I made a mistake in the slides. Any question on this? Now, the next algorithm is last algorithm. Let me make sure my derivation is correct. Number of rounds. Yeah. Okay. Now, the last algorithm is hash bound. Oh, by the way, when this is a condition, what's your joint cost? I forgot to argue that. What's the joint cost? The baseline sort merge joint is sort R sort S plus R plus S, right? Linear scan R and S. In this improvement, however, if M is greater or equal than LB, L is the larger relation size, what happens? This cost is reduced to, using this refinement, this cost is reduced to what? You still need to pass zero, which is linear scan R, linear scan S, or 2 times of that. You're going to use read and write. And you do this merging phase. After this, you're done. And we do not count the output cost, right? I argued many times. And what's this cost? At the end of the day, you scan every page in R, scan every page in S. So like this. And this condition often is true in practice. Oftentimes it's true. Because m is, remember, m is not the number of pages in the memory, it's the number of tuples you can hold in the memory. That's a huge number given today's memory size. And so basically what you're saying is for most joins, you can do this in linear IOs. That's the conclusion we get. Three times, just do three linear scan of R and S, you're done. Compared to when we started with this semester, what we said, the conceptual way of evaluating join, what do? Produce the cross product, check one by one, that's n squared. So instead of doing a quadratic algorithm, you can actually do join in just linear time. Huge, huge improvement. Huh? So in ULab 3 implementation, if you don't use things like this, obviously the chance of winning is very low. Right? Because somebody is using linear algorithm, you are using something close to quadratic. If you're using single natural join, how can you expect to beat the other implementation? No way. Even if you optimize your simple natural join, which is quadratic, you beef up your implementation to every single optimization you can think of, and the other guy just loosely to an implementation like this, the other person will still end up winning easily. Okay? Alright, so next I'm going to talk about another really interesting observation, a really interesting algorithm, which gave you at the end of the day something like this. However, the condition becomes m only need to be greater or equal than l, small l b. Well, small l equal to the mean of this. And if that condition is true, we can also do this. So obviously this is strictly a better algorithm than this one, right? Because it gives you the same cost, but has a relaxed requirement. You only need to be bigger than the smaller relation square root, rather than the bigger relation square root. How do we do that? Well, we do that using hashing. So far, so good? Any questions? So how do we do that? Okay, so what we do is the following. First of all, let me introduce the baseline algorithm, which is hash join. The idea is you hash R, you hash S into different partitions. So use linear scans for R, apply a hash function, push them into different partitions. Once you're done, you linear scan S, push them through a hash function, push to different partitions. Of course, the hashing is done with respect to the join attribute. Hashing is done on the join attribute from R and S respectively. Now after the hashing, what can you claim? What can you claim? Again, assuming you are doing equality join, natural join. So after the hashing, what can you guarantee?
The ones that you want to merge be in the same buckets.
Fantastic. The one you try to join, the one that potentially will join from R and S, must be in the same bucket. In other words, must be in the same partition of R and S. In other words, so the claim is the following, okay? Tuples from the ith partition of R may join with tuples from the ith partition of S. May, because you may have cleared. So they may not always join, but they may join. And tuples from the ith partition of R will not, guaranteed, will not join with tuples from the j's partition of S. In other words, denote this, let me denote this as Ri. Transfer if I use J, you know the join without. Guaranteed. If, of course, I know it's the J. This is the first statement. You can claim, right? Yes or no? Right? Must be. What's the other claim you can make? Any joint results from J, it must be if T belong to Ri. It must be that S belongs to S. But these two claims must be true. Now it's simple, right? You partition R into these Ris, you partition S into those Si's. In the second phase, what do? You load Ri. Load Si, you join them in memory. Of course, you can do better because loading Ri and Si at the same time require a memory that's big enough to hold Ri and Si. What you can do is load Ri in its entirety, linear scan through Si. You only need one page to hold the page on Si. You read page by page and do a meaningless loop between the Si page and all the pages in Ri. Of course, reserve one hop buffer. Of course, alternatively, you can do that for S, right? So the only condition is what? The size must be less than minus 2. One for input buffer, one for output buffer, or when this condition is true, what happens? For any partition up, right? When this condition is true, what happens? You can do the join by looking at every partition only once. What's the total cost? In the first phase, in the hashing phase, you load R once, write down into different partitions, you write R once. So that's 2. R, of course, you do the same thing for 2 of S. And if this condition is true, you can do the join by looking at each partition from R and S only once. The cost of that is simply this. In other words, this gives you simply this. You follow me? Yes or no? And now let's understand this condition. Let's transfer this condition, right? What does this condition say? Well, what this condition says is that assuming you are using a good hash function, a universal hash family you are using. So the distribution of tuples to different partitions are roughly uniform. So roughly, this is the number of pages in R divided by how many partitions you have. How many partitions you can have? You need to reserve one for the input buffer, you hash them into this many output buffer pages. And each output buffer page represents a partition. So this many partitions. If you ignore the constant, roughly this is what it is. In other words, Si must be similar. Right? So what's the condition? The condition basically says the mean of must less than the minimum of the two. And this basically equal to small l. If we ignore the constant, let's ignore the constant. Roughly means this, where and this gives you the condition against the sophomore joint improvement where it requires both give you this cost. And obviously this is a more friendly condition, right? Basically what it says, translate, okay, I use a real life example, right? What it says is you are going to win $3,000. One says you have to get A in database in order to win $3,000. The other says you only need to get A in either database or history in order to win $3,000. That's a relaxed condition. Does that make sense? N is my smart hour. So to be consistent with the slide, okay, we're almost done with query evaluation. Now, that's for the joint algorithm, right? But so far all the joint algorithms we talk about, they are for equality joint conditions, right? What about the general joint condition? And by the way, you may wonder, right? If this is the case, why people still bother doing sort of joint? Why don't you just do hash joint all the time? Right? So there are two reasons for it. One is to support general joint conditions. Sorting may still be useful for doing general joint condition, like A less than B. Because once you sort them, you can still check this condition fairly efficiently using this block idea. You join all the blocks from R that's less than the current cursor, the block pointed by the cursor in S. When that's not true, you advance the cursor. So the same algorithm still holds. That make sense? So join actually works, sort actually works for general joint condition, but hash does not, obviously. Hash doesn't support. Basically, the fundamentals here are sorting enable you to do range queries, and hashing only enable you to do equality queries. That translates to sorting help you with general joint condition, like single joint. And hash joint does not. That's reason number one. Second point is to do with query optimization.
to do query optimization.
Remember, you are not simply doing join, right? Maybe you are doing a join, then you do a group by. By the join condition. Or distinct keyword. Then sorting actually helps you to do the next query, right? Group by, you mean, this might not be a good example because you may argue hash also help you with. Well, think about this. Okay? And suppose this join condition is A equal to B, this is A equal to C. What happens now? And you know, and given T is already sorted by A, by C. If you know this is the condition, yes, to do this one, hashing is more efficient, but to do this whole thing, sort or join for this, will be efficient, because once you do the sort or join for this, the output is automatically sorted by A, and knowing that T is already sorted by C, you can immediately do the last step by doing this cursor thing again. So the total cost, if you do the sort or join, what's the total cost? The total cost is 3 times, because at the end of this, is the whole thing is already sorted, and T is already sorted, plus the join side of this, plus T. If you use sort or join, the input, the refinement, versus if you're using hashing, what's the cost in this case? If you use hashing, that's what you have to do. Right? Yeah? So hash sort one is still very useful. But how do you figure this out? Knowing this and do this, do that, this is what we call optimizer, and this is what we're going to talk about next. Yep, this is what we're going to talk about next. Now before I go into optimization, let me talk about, briefly mention some other operators in SQL and how you're supposed to implement them. What about set operators? Well, intersection and cross product are special cases of join. Intersection is a special case of join, obviously. And union and except are similar, because one is to do this, so use three colors. And except is to do so union is to find the whole thing. In other words, union is blue plus black plus green. And the except is just to find blue, right? But in both cases, essentially it boils down to find out on this part. Find out this part. And essentially it boils down to, you know, I will skip this really quick. I will explain this really quick and skip this part. It boils down to duplicate elimination, the same thing. To find duplicate records. Okay, so I will skip this. Impact buffering. So a lot of things we talk about in query evaluation, like selection, projection, and all that. But take page nested with join example. Page nested with join example. What does page nested with join does? Well, you load the page from R, you linear scan through all the pages from S. Right? But keep in mind, database management system, DBMS. The bigger picture, what's the bigger picture? The bigger picture is that as a buffer. However, DBMS run on top of what? Your operating system. And your operating system have what? Operating system manage your entire RAM. So that's the picture. Yes, when we do page nested with join, we load a single page at a time, but your operating system might do some optimization like prefetching and all that stuff. When it detects that my RAM is sufficiently large and your DBMS from the OS point of view, DBMS is just a single process. And if you are busy doing something, I might just allocate more RAM space to you for the time being. So then page nested with join automatically becomes something similar to block nested with join without DBMS being aware of that. Does that make sense? So using this simple example, what this slide tells you is you need to be always be aware of the impact of quote-unquote buffering, because DBMS runs on top of OS, it's a complex piece of software, complex piece of system. So our analysis here is really just a guideline. In real systems, the performance may vary from time to time. However, as a general guideline, this analysis is fairly accurate in predicting the performance of your system. However, it's never going to be exactly accurate for the reason I mentioned. Okay. Alright, so that's that. Let's move on to the what? Before I forgot, let me just make sure I see this. I'm gonna make a bunch of corrections, I may forgot. I hate this stupid. So I do this later. It's really, really stupid. Okay. You know, what they're doing essentially one in 1 out of 100 of your database workloads need a memory of 1 terabyte, and most other workloads need only 100 gigabytes of RAM. Then somebody say, oh, let's pay the money and get 1 terabyte RAM. Make sure we are safe. Make sure we are extremely safe. That's essentially what they're doing. And university end up paying $1 million to do just that. That's essentially what they're doing. Yes, there were cases where this is absolutely needed. In 1 out of 100 cases, maybe a hacker will hack into your system without two-factor authentication.
But then to make sure it's bulletproof, even in that slight chance, I spend $1 million to beef up the system to do it. Right? All right, that's my 1 minute rant about this. Okay, now.
We have 4 minutes left. You can keep ranting.
Yeah, no, university, but keep in mind, university doesn't pay me to rant. Right? University pays me to teach and do research. Right? So. All right, so that's. Okay, that's. Well, what I'm saying is, the money we use to do that, why not use that money and increase my salary a little bit? And I'm more. I would be more energized in teaching and doing my research. Okay, all right, so let's talk about pre-optimization. So, the picture is you have SQL query, you generate a query plan, as you see in SimpleDB. Right? You have a SQL query, generate a query plan, right? You execute. Now, with the discussion we had, now if I give you if, that's a big if, but if I give you a query plan, you should be able to access the query now, right? Because I talked about the algorithm for selection, for protection, for group by, for join. If I give you a query plan, you just do it bottom up, right? Start from this, oh, you tell me to scan, I do scan. You tell me hash, I use hybrid hashing, or two-phase hashing. You tell me sort, I use external sort. You tell me join, you have to tell me which join I want to use, block as a join or whatever. No matter how complex your query is, as soon as you give me this query plan, I can start executing. No problem. All right. Now, what's missing though is how do you generate such a query plan in the first place? That's what we're going to talk about today. Okay? That's what we're going to talk about in query optimization. So you have an SQL, you output this query plan and represent as a tree, essentially as you see from here. Tree-like structure. Right. In this case, it's a join between reserve and sitter, do a selection, and do the final connection. That's the query. And query optimization is about selecting a plan that's, first of all, you need to make sure you're doing something correct. Right? In other words, the query plan produced must be equivalent to the input query. Right? Don't try to over-optimize. If you optimize too much, maybe you end up with a really efficient plan, but that's wrong. Right? Then it's no use at all. Right? So the first thing you need to ensure is the plan you produce is correct. And based on that, with that being said, your next objective is to make sure that you find a good plan. You don't find something that's really expensive. To motivate that, I'm going to use this example to show you. So I will come back to this later, right? So I'm going to use this example to show you why query optimization is important. Again, we're going to use this setup, right? Each tuple 40 bytes for the reserve, 100 tuples per page, and 1,000 pages, assuming there are 100 loads. And sitters, we assume each tuple 50 bytes, that have 80 tuples per page, 500 pages, and assuming there are 10 different readings, and we'll have 5 pages in the buffer pool. Okay, that's what we have. Now, if I do a page-oriented next loop join, that's my query plan. What's my cost? What is my cost? What's my cost? Well, sitter is 500 pages, reserve is 1,000 pages. If you use sitter as outer relation, that's essentially this cost. Right? That's the page oriented natural join. And you do the selection on the fly, meaning whenever you produce a drawn result from this join, instead of writing it to disk and load them back into the buffer, you apply the selection condition on the fly in that
one by one, you load sellers. This is reserve. You loop them through. And whenever you find a join to the output buffer, you apply the selection condition right there. Before pushing to this, that's what I mean by on the fly. You follow me? So it introduces no additional cost, so the cost is simply this. What if I push down the selection operator? I think I'm trying to push to my left. Why don't we stop right here instead of me rushing? Okay? I will stop right here. See you on Tuesday.